Today we're talking about depositions in California Superior Court. Depositions are authorized by the Discovery Act under CCP, Code of Civil Procedure 2025.010 et sec, which goes through the entire 2025 series. So this is a method of obtaining discovery in a civil action, which is pretty straightforward. It basically consists of a witness, whether it's an expert, a percipient witness, or otherwise, giving testimony in front of a court reporter under oath and being asked questions by an opposing attorney. Generally, what happens is that a notice of deposition is sent out during the case, and the attorneys will agree when certain witnesses are going to have their depositions taken. If you're one of my clients, you'll have either myself or one of my associates defending the deposition. If you're not one of my clients, you'll have your own attorney, hopefully, defending the deposition. So what happens is you will show up either on Zoom or in person, most likely Zoom because I haven't done an in-person deposition for a couple years now because of COVID. So as COVID has changed the face of society, it's changed the way we practice law. So you will need to be somewhere with a good internet connection, because the last thing you want and the last thing I would want if I'm your attorney is your connection to be going up and down or freezing up during the deposition. It's no fun and it's very stressful for all involved. If you don't have a good connection at home, go take the deposition in your attorney's office where they have a solid connection. Okay, day of your deposition. Hopefully you've been prepared by either watching this video in some cases, or you've spoken to your attorney about potential weaknesses in your case and what issues you want to stress, what issues you want to avoid. That's between you and your attorney. That's going to be completely privileged under the evidence code, and they're not going to be able to ask you questions about that. However, they're going to be able to ask you questions about just about anything else. Anything in the entire universe of facts, which may be reasonably calculated to lead to discovery of admissible evidence, I know that that's a mouthful, essentially, is it relevant or will it lead to relevant evidence? That's a huge umbrella. It's a huge net that's being cast out there. So essentially, unless your attorney specifically advises you not to answer a question based on a specific privilege, such as attorney-client privilege or spousal privilege, you're going to have to answer every question that's asked of you. Okay? In terms of who will be present at the deposition, you're going to be there. If you're represented by counsel, hopefully your attorney will be there. The opposing side's attorney will be there asking you questions. And the other side has the right to appear at the deposition, just as they have a right to appear at any other hearing in their action. There will also be a court reporter. The court reporter will be taking down in shorthand, which takes down sounds instead of letters, so allows them to type a lot faster, everything that's said at the deposition. So at your deposition, you're going to have someone there that's going to be paying very close attention to every word that comes out of your mouth. This is important for a number of reasons. First of all, if you're nodding to questions or you're shaking your head, the court reporter can't take those down. If you're going, same thing. Those are very difficult to take down. You want to answer affirmatively or negatively. Answer yes, answer no, or I don't understand. Those are acceptable answers during your deposition. Another thing that's usually done in depositions is, it shouldn't be done, but it's done in every deposition, is people talking over each other. Now, it sounds very rude, like I would never talk over someone, but in normal day-to-day conversations, people sometimes anticipate questions or they anticipate answers, and they interrupt each other in a very, you know, friendly way. It's not meant to be abrasive. However, in deposition, that can be problematic in that the court reporter taking down every single word is not going to be able to take down people talking over each other. So it's very, very important when you're having your deposition taken to not talk over each other, to allow the attorney asking the questions to finish their questions. If you don't understand a question, make sure you say, I don't understand. Vague and misformed questions will commonly be asked at depositions. And the last thing your attorney wants, and frankly, by extension, the last thing you want is to answer a question that's unclear or out of context, or that you don't fully understand, and you end up with an answer later. Remember, all this is under oath. You have to take your oath in front of the court reporter before you start. It can be problematic later on. So if you don't understand a question, let the attorney know, take a break, talk to your attorney, whatever it takes to make sure that you only answer questions that you fully understand, okay? The party asking the questions is entitled to your best estimate. They're not entitled to guesses. If you don't understand something, if you don't know something and you're going to have to be forced to guess, make sure you tell them that. Nobody wants that. That's not what the purpose of civil discovery is about. It's not for you to guess. It's for you to give accurate, honest, and complete testimony about facts that you have percipient knowledge of. So that's essentially the anatomy of a deposition. But the issue is these depositions will go usually all day. That means 7 hours, usually 6 hours of testimony, maybe five and a half. In employment cases, they can go sometimes multiple days. Most commonly in an employment case, you are looking at a day and a half, 2 days of deposition on average. In certain cases that are very factually intensive, where there's a lot of witnesses or disputed facts, you could go potentially days. Now, generally under the Discovery Act, as it's been amended over the years, depositions are limited to 7 hours of testimony. However, there are multiple exceptions for that. The most important one for what we're doing now in this video is employment cases. Employment cases are specifically carved out. They can go as long as they need to go without becoming burdensome or problematic. Same thing with persons most qualified, which means certain witnesses for businesses that are defendants. Those depositions are not limited. And they wouldn't be anyways because these are employment cases we're talking about anyways. So you're looking at least 7 hours of deposition testimony. It can get very, very tiring. The purpose of this video is to, one, prepare you, and two, to help make that time go a little bit faster because you understand what's expected of you, you understand what it is that you will be facing, and it will allow you to hopefully get through this with as little problem as possible. So during the day, your attorney's also going to be making objections to certain questions at the deposition. The objections will sound something like vague, not reasonably calculated to lead to discovery of admissible evidence, argumentative, compound. For the most part, you can try and ignore your attorney's objections. They're not going to affect your ability to answer those questions. If there's a question that your attorney feels you shouldn't be answering at all, they will instruct you not to answer on the record. It'll sound something like this. So, deponent, what did you and your attorney talk about this morning before the deposition? The attorney would object. It's attorney-client privilege, counsel. You're not allowed to ask that. I would instruct my client not to answer. At that point, the attorney taking the deposition is going to ask the deponent, in this case you, so are you going to take your attorney's advice not to answer? And you're saying, yeah, of course, they're my attorney. I'm taking their advice. And then that can sometimes lead to problems down the line, but let your attorney worry about that because sometimes the other side can go into court and can order to compel you to answer certain questions. But if your attorney's telling you not to answer specific questions, they probably know what they're doing and they probably, appreciating the fact they could get sanctioned by the court, they're really only telling you not to answer questions that are completely improper. Okay. So like I said, deposition goes 7 hours. Deposition will start with the other side giving you something called an admonishment. Although admonishments are technically improper under the code and not an authorized form of discovery, they'll go on for about 10, 15 minutes about, do you know you're under the penalty of perjury? Do you understand perjury? Do you understand the difference between a guess and an estimate, and give a bunch of examples. It's not something I do very much, but 99% of attorneys out there will give you admonitions for about 10, 15 minutes. Again, it's not authorized by the code. It's just them basically lecturing you, but it's part of this song and dance that we have to do. So after that, they're going to start asking you questions. It's very important to let them finish for the reasons we discussed before about the court reporter, but also because you want to give your attorney a moment, a second, or half a second even, to jump in with an objection between the question and you answering the question. Remember, you want a clean record. Later, if a judge has to get involved in your case, they're going to look at the transcript, and if it's all messy and people are jumping on each other, it's a lot harder for the judge to understand your version of events if you are jumping all over each other and you're talking over each other. So remember, number one rule is listen to your attorney. Number two rule is don't talk over each other, okay? So assuming you have a clean record and you're following your attorney's instructions, you should be fine. Mark Twain, one of my favorite writers, said, if you always tell the truth, you never have to remember anything. Okay? That is more true in a deposition than it is anywhere else, except maybe testifying in open court. Okay? Different attorneys have different styles in terms of instructing their clients how to prepare and how to answer questions at deposition. My style is total openness. Okay? The clients I take generally, I shouldn't say generally, specifically in every case, are really, really great people. And they have nothing to hide. So there aren't pressure points where some attorneys say, oh, there's a pressure point in our case. We don't want to talk about this issue. If you have problems in that case and you've discussed them with your attorney and they don't want to talk about certain things or they want you to, light step certain things and then, more heavily emphasize other issues, that's between you and your attorney. And it's part of good strategy and good preparation. In my case, it's the open book. We're here to tell a story. We're here to weave a compelling narrative. And for me, my style and my client's styles, by extension, I should say, is to basically lay it all out there, okay? And to tell that story as authentically and realistically as possible. Now, sometimes during your deposition testimony, you're going to get to a point, usually in the later afternoon, where it's going to trigger some specific emotions and feelings from you. Okay? Some attorneys will coach their clients like, oh, make sure you start crying on the record. And then it leads me to a very important point. You're going to be videotaped on these. So remember, anything you say, anything you do at deposition, your facial expressions, your hands, the way you sit in your chair, the way you squirm around, if you're going to put your hands over your face, it's all going to be on camera. It's going to be shown to a jury if the case goes to trial. That's why it's very important to dress appropriately, to remain calm, and you know, just answer the questions. You know, you've been trained. You've watched this video. You've spoken to your attorney. You know what to expect. Depositions, if you have a qualified attorney, when I say qualified, I don't mean with a license. I mean they've done a few of these before. You're going to be fine, okay? The attorney's done hundreds of these potentially, thousands perhaps. You're in good hands. You chose this attorney because you think they're competent. They're there and they chose you because they believe in your case. As long as you do everything you're supposed to do, you answer honestly, and you try not to get too stressed out, the deposition will go fine, I can assure you. If the deposition is not going fine, if at some point you get upset, if at some point you want to scream or get really upset with someone, that is the time to take a break. There are no limitations on when and how many breaks you can take during a deposition. That being said, if you're taking too many breaks, you're going to be there all day long, potentially 2, 3, 4 days. You want to give them as much information in as short a span of time as possible. But you can take breaks. You're going to get a lunch break. You're going to get multiple other 10, 15-minute breaks during the course of the deposition. Remember, the court reporter who's typing all day, she or he needs breaks too. So you're going to be able to take your breaks, okay? Sometimes I find with my clients in the late afternoon, they tend to get a little irritable, okay? That's not uncommon. In fact, I had a client recently who was an attorney who has defended hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands, of depositions. And yeah, around 2:30, 3 o'clock, he started a little grumpy on camera. So we took a break and I talked to the client. And I said, hey, man, you're getting a little grumpy on camera. And he told me, he goes, yeah, you know what? I've done so many of these, but you're right. It's just, I'm just tired. It gets very grating. And that's an important point that I'd like to make. During these depositions, you're going to be asked the same questions, sometimes multiple different ways. Now, if they ask you the same exact question over and over again, your attorney has an obligation to jump in and say, asked and answered. It's an objection. It's been asked and answered. If you've already gotten your answer, you can't ask the same question over and over again, hoping to get a different answer. But, you know, most attorneys who are doing these type of cases on the defense side are intelligent to know that they can ask a question in different ways, from different angles, from different perspectives, to try and get the same effect. That can get tiring after a period of time. So if you're getting anxious, if you're getting upset, if you're getting tired, if you're getting grumpy, take a break, take 10 minutes, wash your face, get a glass of water, talk to your attorney, check your email, do something. Because the last thing you want is to have a fit on camera that can be shown to the jury. Okay. And just remember, because it's the jury's not going to be shown this previous, the preceding 6 hours of you answering questions intelligently and kindly, they're going to be shown the parts where you're not handling the questions right, and you're essentially, you know, freaking out. So let's not have that on camera. If you're going to freak out, take a break. It's not uncommon for people to get very upset, to be overcome with emotion, with anxiety, with anger, with rage, given what they've gone through and given the fact that they're reliving it again. And it can trigger a lot of complex emotions. And the goal is to have those emotions played out, off camera instead of on camera. Okay. To a certain extent, it's kind of like, I wouldn't say it's like a game. I mean, it has a lot of rules, and you know, you can win or you can lose, but if you do what you're supposed to do, you get through it and you get, you know, B+ performance, it's fine, okay? No one's expected to be on their A game, A+ game for 7 hours straight. You're gonna have your highs and you're gonna have your lows, okay? If you have questions for your attorney, take a break, ask the attorney a question. A lot of defense attorneys, when they're asking you questions, they'll get upset and they'll say, oh, you can't take a break until you answer my question. That's not actually true under the code, but sometimes just to remain cordial and not have a big fight take place between the attorneys, yes, answer the question and take your break. Importantly, after you take your break and you've spoken to your attorney, if you want to change any answers to any questions you'd given before, please do so. Keep in mind that any testimony you give during a deposition can and probably will be used against you in a court of law. Just like they say on TV, if you give a bad answer, if the question is, were you discriminated against at work? And you say, not really, you're done. Your case is over. So if they're asking specific questions, were you retaliated against? Were you discriminated against? Were you harassed at work? If the answer to those questions are no, you have no business bringing a case. So that's a discussion you need to have very clearly with your attorney before you start. What are the facts of the case? What are the theories of the case? What causes of action? If you're suing for discrimination but not harassment, and they ask, are you being harassed? No. You're being discriminated against? You better say yes, or else your case is going to get thrown out on something called a motion for summary judgment, which is a big phone book size document they're going to file with the court to throw out your case, and they're going to use all your words against you at deposition. They're going to use transcripts, which we'll get to in a few minutes, transcripts of your testimony at deposition to basically destroy your entire case. We don't want that. The whole purpose of this video, the whole purpose of this undertaking really, is to prepare you for your deposition and to give you the same speech I give to all my clients before I let them be deposed, okay? So you've been there all day, you've endured all kinds of questions. Your attorney may get into it with the other attorney. If both attorneys are good attorneys and they're there to do their job and represent their client's interests very well, the attorneys are not gonna fight. They're gonna get along. If it's employment, a lot of times the defense firms know the plaintiff's attorney and they get along and they respect each other and there's not gonna be any fights. Under certain circumstances, your attorney may get into a dispute, let's say, with the opposing counsel. If the opposing counsel is asking questions that are clearly improper, if they're behaving in an abusive or condescending manner, I would hope your attorney would speak up. Now, people who act disgustingly towards others generally are not very good at accepting responsibility for their actions or even being self-aware. That will result in some conflict sometimes. It's very important. You need to kind of pull back and tune out from that. Just because your attorney is having a very, say, difficult or elevated volume conversation with opposing counsel on the record, you can't let that get to you, that you need to focus on what you're doing. And if they're gonna have it out, you gotta trust them to deal with it on their own, okay? It's like parents fighting at the dinner table when you're a kid. You gotta stay out of it, okay? Some clients get very upset. I found in the past when I've had to jump in forcefully to stop improper conduct by opposing counsel. So it's something I like to bring into the conversation when preparing people for their depositions, is don't worry about it. It may happen. You know, if they're good attorneys, they won't, but there's a saying that says the personality of the attorney usually reflects the personality of the defendant, or the client, I should say. In this case, we're talking about defendants. We're talking about defendants that have done some racist, discriminatory, harassing, retaliatory stuff, and oftentimes they will pick a disgusting attorney to represent them because they want to punish the employee over and over again for filing a case. The exception to that really is if there's good insurance on the table. There's employment practices liability, EPLI insurance. They will generally hire the same, about a dozen firms or so, and the attorneys there are not paid extra to abuse the plaintiff. They are there to basically do their jobs. So it may happen. I wouldn't count on it. It does happen sometimes, but I wouldn't worry about that in particular. So the last part that we're going to talk about of the deposition is after the deposition adjourns. So after you've given all your testimony for the day, they're going to wrap it up, and the court reporter may have some questions for you, may ask you about certain names, spellings of names. Then after that, you're done. In about a week or two, you're going to get in either the email or in mail, regular mail, is a copy of the transcript, a draft. Either it's going to be electronic as a PDF, or you'll get one, hard copy, which are more and more rare these days, and you will go through the deposition and you will be allowed to make corrections. There are two types of corrections to be made in a deposition transcript. There are minor typographical corrections. Say you said, 8:30 a.m. is when I started work, and then the court reporter for some reason put 9:30 a.m. or 9:30 p.m. Those are small typographical errors. Say they misspell a name. Say, you said, I did not make that phone call on that date, and they put, I did make the phone call. These happen. These people are human. Those are normal mistakes that can be corrected during the process of you reviewing your transcript. It's very important you take your time. The second time are substantive changes to the reporter's transcript. That happens when you answered a question, and either one of two things have happened. One, the circumstances have changed, and you need to give a different response. Or two, essentially, you thought about the question, you have a different answer. Now, when you're getting admonished at the beginning of your deposition, they're going to tell you, they're going to warn you, if you make changes to your deposition transcript, I get the chance to comment on it at trial. True, but so what? It's better to have them comment at trial that you made a substantive change to your deposition transcript than go into potentially a motion for summary judgment where your case gets thrown out because you answered a question in either a sloppy way or you had some type of confusion about it and you and your attorney want to change the answer, it should be done sparingly, exceedingly sparingly. I can't stress that enough. But sometimes, if it's going to make the difference between your case getting thrown out or not, those changes need to be made. Okay, we're at the end of your deposition. You've made your corrections. You send them back. So essentially, what's a deposition transcript used for? Well, two things, really. One is in motions, motions for summary judgment, which are basically motions to dismiss your entire case. They're going to take your deposition testimony, and they're going to take deposition testimony of other parties to the case, and they are going to put it together in a way that makes you look as bad as possible. And that's really why it's important to kind of go through all these processes that we've discussed and have these conversations with your attorney and make those corrections as needed, is because they're going to try and throw your case out based on your own words and the words of other witnesses in the case who will either have their depositions taken or essentially be submitting testimony as part of a declaration. So very important, be careful with your corrections. If they need to be made, make them, okay? The second instance would be, say something happens and you're unavailable to participate in your trial. I've never personally seen that happen, but sometimes witnesses will drop out, flake out, or otherwise disappear. Now, that's important to keep in mind, because if they're not there, their deposition transcript can be used in their absence. So that's something that may happen, but for the most part, we've talked about all the different parts of the anatomy of a deposition. Again, it's the code section is a Code of Civil Procedure 2025.010. So now we've discussed most of the parts of a deposition. Again, if you are curious about a deposition as exists in the California law, you can look at Code of Civil Procedure 2025.010 and start reading that entire chapter. So we've discussed what to discuss with your attorney prior to the deposition, what's expected of you at the deposition, the type of questions you're going to hear, the type of objections you will hear, and what happens after the deposition is wrapped up and you get to make corrections to your deposition transcript. So this video is not intended to be a replacement for you having a meaningful discussion about the merits and facts of your individual case. However, it should give a good 30,000 foot view of what to expect when walking into a deposition. Any questions, please refer them to your attorney, and thank you for watching.